So who remembers that problem that we worked on Friday? Which one could you not answer? Time, right? That was the only one that actually that was you could answer it in the sense that you could write not enough information to solve this problem. And that's all you had to write on that one to get credit, which, by the way, those are being uploaded, I think, later today. So you should be able to check TritonEd probably early tomorrow and see what those scores are. And then you can pick them up from me in my office whenever you want. I'll carry them around for a little while, too. Anyway, the only one that we couldn't solve, despite all our capabilities with thermodynamics and 100, was anything to do with time. Time is not just something that's useful when you have like a batch reactor and you want to know how long to leave it in there. It's also really important whenever you have flow because time is sort of implied in flow. How long do those materials reside inside your reactor? How long do they have to react? So time shows up whether or not you're talking about a steady state system or a batch system, which is dependent on time. If you review the syllabus, we're going to stick with batch reactors for about the first 4 weeks or so, because we can learn an awful lot about the general kinetics that we're going to deal with in other problems just looking at batch reactors. All the other reactors have additional complications because they add a flow coming in or a flow going out, and the behavior of the material inside the reactor is a little bit different. But you'll see that those modifications are pretty small. All the same tools we need for a batch reactor are going to show up again on flow reactors when we get to them. The terms that involve time aren't going to show up today. They don't show up till tomorrow. If you want to know what that term is, the term that we're going to spend a lot of our time, in fact, the only difference really between anything you did in 102 and 113 or 100 versus 113 is a single letter R sub I, which is the rate of reaction. It may have shown up in other places here and there. That is the big focus of 113. It's something that doesn't show up commonly in 100 or 102. That's chemical reaction engineering, right? It's paying attention to whatever happens with this new rate of reaction term. Where do those terms come from? How do they impact fluids when they move through tubes or move through basically stirred batch reactors? It all comes down to this rate of reaction. Before we can define the rate of reaction, there are some terms that go into the rate of reaction that aren't quite the same as what we have seen before, or they are actually identically the same. They just have a different letter because why not? And so we're going to spend today introducing those new terms, which are the X, the C, the delta, and this is a theta symbol. If you've never seen an uppercase theta before, that is an uppercase theta. It looks like a circle with a little squat H inside of it. That's an uppercase theta. So we're going to have those terms today. You have already seen X before in a different form. You've probably seen C before in one of your chemistry classes. Delta and theta are a little bit different. So we're going to see how those impact mostly the stoichiometric table. That's where we're going to spend most of our time so that tomorrow we can introduce this rate of reaction and talk about that for a couple of weeks. Before we get to X, CI, delta, and theta, just as a reminder, everything with homework one was last week. So anything that we go over here is not needed for homework one. One of those variables, I tried to introduce it for you in homework one, just so that you've seen it before. There's an X in homework one, and I defined it in there so that you know what it looks like. But nothing that we're going to talk about in here has anything to do with homework one. That'll all be for homework two, which will get posted later tonight. Any questions before we hit these topics? I'm guessing it'll be the full 40 minutes or something that we have left, but we might be able to finish early. I notice everybody shuts up when I say, like, we might finish early. And then you're like, well, I'm not going to talk about anything then. The two expressions that we had from 100. When we first defined what a reaction looks like in CENG 100, we did two things. Three things. We always wrote in white. And then in 100, we had that definition of the extent of reaction, which we usually rearranged that definition so that we could write something like the moles of species I going out or the moles of I after the reaction is equal to the moles of I initially present or being fed to the reactor plus the stoichiometric coefficient times squiggle. And generally that was for any reaction, A plus B goes to C plus D. We're still going to stick with that particular nomenclature. That hasn't changed very much. But the extent of reaction doesn't get used very often for a single good reason, which is if you have only a single reaction, the conversion is actually a little bit more intuitive. For example, if you ever want to know what's the conversion in my reactor, it always scales between essentially 0 and 1. It's possible to have negative conversion, but usually that just means you wrote your reaction the wrong way around and you flip it and then it becomes positive. Conversion tends to be the thing that we use more often when we have a single reaction for that reason. We have some intuition about how big the number is, right? It's got to scale between 0 and 1. It's always got to be positive. And there's some level of intuition that says higher conversion is better, right? We also know that higher extent of reaction is better, but higher conversion is better is maybe a little bit more intuitive. We would like to convert more of our product. So as a result, we also introduce a new term specifically for the world of reaction engineering, which is the conversion. The only difference between this conversion and the conversion you learned in 100 is the letter. So now we say conversion is the letter X instead of the letter F. I have no idea why they chose X. That's what everybody uses. The other thing that you'll notice, actually let's finish that definition here. The definition has not changed. It's in minus out divided by N. Or if you're talking about a batch reactor like we are going to for the first couple of weeks, it's sort of like saying before minus after divided by before. So the moles initially present minus the moles present when the reaction is done divided by the moles initially present. Either one of those is fine. It's defined in the same way. This is defined in exactly the same way as the F that you would have seen in CENG 100. We're just not going to carry the F around anymore. We don't need it. The other difference, which we probably would have done in 100, but we may not have adhered to it perfectly, is that subscript that's on there. The subscript that's on there, and I usually forget how to draw this, refers to a specific species. Which species it is kind of depends on whatever you want, right? It can be any species that you want. Usually there's some indicator as to which species you ought to be picking, right? I will ask you, tell me the conversion of hydrogen. Therefore, species A, whatever A happens to be, is probably hydrogen because I'm talking about the conversion of hydrogen. You can still write conversion for everything, but usually we pick a single species that we're interested in and only talk about conversion of that species. It doesn't mean you can't calculate all the other ones. We just don't usually do it explicitly. As a result, you will never see an X in here that doesn't have a subscript, unless it happens to be completely obvious which X it is, like if there's only one species involved and it's just going back and forth between something else, then it's always talking about conversion of the reactant. But there almost always has to be a subscript on there. That subscript is whatever species is most relevant. In practice, that species can be either the one that's most expensive, and therefore you want to convert as much of it as you can. It could be the one that's the most difficult to obtain for some other reason, although that's usually related to how expensive it is. Or it could be, no, mostly just those two. I can't really think of a third reason why you would want to do something like that. Usually it comes down to money, but in terms of the problems that you'll solve, it should be fairly clear which species A we're talking about in there. If you combine these two expressions, you can end up with something like this, which is the moles of any species I is equal to the initial moles of A, again, A is whatever we happen to want it to be, times a quantity of the moles of I initial minus the moles of A initial, minus the stoichiometric coefficient of I divided by the stoichiometric coefficient of A times the conversion of A. So this expression should look somewhat similar to this one. The big difference here is, first, we've put in the conversion of A, and second, you can see the species A actually shows up a lot. We don't need all those species of A. You could distribute that NA0 on the outside through all the terms on the inside, but we do that because this particular setup simplifies things a little bit on the stoichiometric table. There's a couple of terms that are in here. This one is one of them. This term is usually not written as those two species divided by each other. That is theta sub I. So theta sub I is defined as the moles of I initially present over the moles of A initially present. So naturally, according to that definition, A cannot be the thing that is not initially present, or theta will be infinite. That's just the definition. There's nothing else that goes into that. We'll see two other versions of theta, all of which are entirely equivalent, but that's the one that we're going to use right now. The other term that we often introduce, actually, do I want to introduce this one now? No, not just yet. This particular term over here, let me narrow that down, just that ratio of stoichiometric coefficients, looks a little bit irritating, and before you really pick up on the pattern of it, you just kind of have to write it out each time. This is usually represented in a shorthand form as instead of minus 1 times the stoichiometric coefficient of I over the stoichiometric coefficient of A, the stoichiometric coefficient of A is always minus little a, right? We wrote it up there on the top. And so this often looks like the stoichiometric coefficient of I divided by A. That's usually how you will see it written. As you write it a couple of dozen times, you'll see that those two are equivalent. It's just that the stoichiometric coefficient of A is always minus A, and so that term tends to look like that. As a result, this particular expression here in the middle for N sub I, you will often see it written in an equivalent form, which looks like this. And this is the one that we often use for stoichiometric tables. So the moles of I is equal to the moles of A initially present times theta I, capital theta I, plus the stoichiometric coefficient of I divided by A times x sub A. That's the more common way that you will see it. The stoichiometric coefficients, the nus in the top, still follow that plus minus kind of convention where anything for a reactant is negative, anything for a product is positive. And that's usually a slightly easier way to not make a mistake of leaving a negative sign in there somewhere. But you can always write it the way that the previous expression was, and that's fine. For the very first example, I will write it out in the full expression. We can use, this is often what goes into the stoichiometric table, and it goes into the table in almost exactly the same way. Instead of squiggles or extensive reactions, we now have X's. So if we have a reaction like 2A plus B goes to C, and there's initially 3 moles of A and 1 mole of B and no C. If we want to write a stoichiometric table for something like that using this form that we have up top, most of it looks pretty similar to what we would have written before. So we still have species, stoichiometric coefficient of I, initial moles of I. I'm going to add two columns on here. You might recall sometimes we write the delta column when we're comparing moles before and moles after. Sometimes we don't. It just depends on whether it's obvious. You don't have to write the following two columns if it becomes obvious to you whether or not they should be there or not. But I want to try to describe each one of these in detail. And you can always write them, and then you're not worried about making a mistake. One is theta I, and the other is nu sub I over nu sub A. And then the last column that we have is n sub I. So we fill this out pretty much the same way. It goes A, B, C, because we have 3 species. What was my reaction? 2A and 1B, so minus 2 for A, minus 1 for B, and plus 1 for C. Moles initial, that just came from our problem statement, so 3, 1, and 0. Theta I is always talking about the ratio of anything else relative to how much A started. So the first one is pretty easy because that one is always 1, because 3 divided by 3 is 1. The second one is 1 divided by however much is initially present. So this one is 1/3. The third one for C is however much C you started with divided by how much A you started with. So that's talking about 0 divided by 3, which is 0. The stoichiometric coefficients, again, you always get a 1 for an A because the stoichiometric coefficient of A divided by the stoichiometric coefficient of A is 1. The stoichiometric coefficient of B is minus 1 divided by the stoichiometric coefficient of A, which is minus 2, gives you a 1 half right here. That's where the negative signs can sometimes get you into trouble. It depends on which version you're using. You can use either one because they're equivalent. The only difference is whether or not there's a plus sign here because we've already taken into account that negative sign of A here. Or if you look back at the previous version over here, there was a minus sign here because we were just talking about the generic stoichiometric coefficient of A, not specifically minus A. And I realize that that can seem unnecessarily confusing, but that's the terminology that we've got. And then the last one for C, the stoichiometric coefficient of C, according to that, is plus 1. And the stoichiometric coefficient of A is minus 2. So you're stuck with minus 1 half here. The first, I don't know, dozen times or something that you write this out, put those two columns in there. It'll save you a mistake partway through. After you get a little bit more comfortable with it, then you can write things a little bit more quickly without having to actually write each one of those columns. Although most of the time when I'm writing these things, I still end up writing all of those out just to make sure that I don't make a mistake. This one for the moles of A coming out of the reactor or the moles of A after the reaction occurs almost invariably looks like Na0 times 1 minus Xa. If you ever see any coefficients in there, double check it, because it's kind of odd to see anything other than a 1 there and nothing in front of the Xa. The other ones are the ones that look a little bit odd. It's also very easy to make mistakes here because you have a tendency to follow that pattern and not forget or not remember which ones change and which ones don't. So N sub B, this is the first of several mistakes. It's very easy to write N sub B 0 right there, but it's not, right? The way that we factored out an N sub A 0 when we derived that expression up at the top, so it's always an NA 0 that comes out up front. The NB 0 is essentially captured inside theta B. So theta B for this one is 1/3. And then we have to subtract off whatever our nu sub I over nu sub A is. So minus, what did I say that was, 1/2? X sub A. And N sub C looks something similar. This one actually gets much simpler. It's just 1/2 Na0 times Xa. The reason there's no product or no term there inside parentheses is because theta I for species C was initially 0. Right, so that term isn't there anymore, and it just looks like Na0. This is sort of pushing you in the direction of recognizing why we always turn everything into in terms of A, because we can rewrite everything over here in terms of nothing except how much A was initially there, how much of whatever else was initially there, and the conversion of A. So whichever A parameter you come up with is an important one. And then you can sum these things up in the normal way. So this one doesn't look any different. The moles initially present, N sub T0, in this case is just 4. The moles of everything else present after the reaction looks a little bit different. So it's still equal to the moles initially present plus some kind of a modifier for any moles that were destroyed or created during the reaction. Remember, we can't destroy or create atoms, but we can destroy and create molecules. So the overall number of moles can change. We still sum that up in exactly the same way that we would have with extensive reaction. The only difference is a new parameter that often gets involved in there. If you sum these up, even in a general form, you'll find that this is equal to Na0 times Xa times the sum of minus nu sub I over minus nu sub A. That's the new parameter that we haven't seen before. Hey, I like that. It's new, and it's only got news in it. It's a new parameter. This is why people become professors for that, right there. This is new. It looks a little bit different than what we would have seen before. It's related, right? You can always dump the squiggles back inside of there, and you'll come up with the same squiggle expression you had in 100. But that's a new parameter. This happens to be a pretty useful parameter because it pops up in a lot of different places. But it is slightly different from just the plain old sum of all the stoichiometric coefficients, right? All those stoichiometric coefficients have been normalized by the stoichiometric coefficient of A. So it's slightly different from the sum of stoichiometric coefficients, for example, that shows up in KP. Fortunately, all exams in here have one page of notes, so you don't have to memorize all of these. You can write them down. We have a special term for that, which I will just briefly repeat that. You can probably just write after whatever you had there in the bottom of your notes. So when N sub t is equal to the moles initially present plus Na0 times Xa times this sum of minus nu sub a over, or nu sub I divided by nu sub a, this term is defined as delta. Delta represents the overall change in moles for the system, right? If I add up all the moles that are on the left-hand side of the reaction versus all the moles on the right-hand side, it's either positive, zero, or negative. And it doesn't have to be an integer. It can be fractions very commonly. There's nothing wrong with that. Often you will see delta written this way, which is for that general reaction, D over A plus C over A minus B over A minus 1. And that's just somebody being cute, plugging in the A's, the B's, and the C's, and taking their signs into account. That's usually what it ends up looking like in practice. But the definition of delta is what we've got up there. So if delta is 0, that tends to mean that, actually, that exactly means that there is no change in moles, overall moles, for that particular reaction. And I think that's three of them, right? That's the XA, that's the theta I of whatever theta of whatever component I you're worried about, and delta. There's only one delta per reaction. That's why there's no subscript on there. It's not per species, it's per reaction. But theta varies with species, and X sub A is usually for a single reaction. Any questions on anything that's here? Stoic table looks pretty much the same, and that's where this is used, is within a stoic table somewhere. You can calculate also one of these x's in the same way that we could do squiggle at equilibrium. So there was the general squiggle that we saw before. You could also calculate a squiggle at equilibrium, which was fine. It's the same old squiggle that we're always dealing with, except it's defined specifically for systems that are at equilibrium. You can define x's in the same way. So there's the normal everyday x that just says x at any time, at any location. You can also say xa eq to represent x at equilibrium. I don't think there's any other x's that we use in there. Sometimes that eq is down on the bottom. It depends on whether or not I want to use a caret or a subscript. These two are the same thing. We just add more subscripts, superscripts to them to denote equilibrium. Cool. Okay, the other part is a little bit more of a pain in the butt. And in fact, judging by how much time we've got, we might be able to cover it. This one is much more useful for rate laws for a very good reason. Rate laws are based on a probabilistic interpretation of when things collide and whether they collide with enough energy to react. Those probabilities can be derived in terms of concentration. Concentration here has a specific definition that's not the same concentration as like a mole fraction or a mass fraction. It's a very specific kind of concentration. Concentration is usually, or always for this class, given the letter C. And it's always C subscript I for whatever species you have, so like C sub A, C sub B, C sub D. And this is always equal to the moles of I divided by the total volume of the system. We're going to see another version of that for a flow system, because a flow system doesn't use just total volume, but this V is volume. How do we use CI? I mean, the primary use of CI is through the rate laws that we're going to learn tomorrow. But there's two other uses of CI, one to figure out what's there initially and one that's there to figure out what's there afterwards. And so if you want to know how to use CI to learn more about what's initially present inside your reactor, the amount of stuff initially present is usually given the symbol CI0. And this CI0 is defined as the moles initially present, NI0, divided by the initial volume. This is also why I didn't use zeros for the reference state when we were doing all the thermo stuff, because the zeros already show up everywhere else. And the reference state does not need to correspond to the initial state, which is why I used two different symbols for something like that. For example, one that you'll often encounter is just the initial concentration of A. Is the moles of A initially present divided by the initial volume. Oh, sorry, CA is here. But you can write one of those for every single species you've got, including inerts. All of those can get C. For liquids, this doesn't really mean anything special. You know the volume of a liquid, and you know the amount of that stuff that's initially there. So calculating CI0 is not particularly difficult. There's not really very many ways that I can give you an initial liquid composition or liquid concentration without just giving you the initial liquid concentration. But I can be tricky with gases and give you something that's related to initial concentration through the ideal gas law. So if you have a gas system, you still get that C sub I0 is equal to the initial moles divided by the initial volume. But if you use the ideal gas equation, this is equal to the partial pressure of I initially divided by R times the initial temperature. And remember from our discussion of partial pressure for Kp, the partial pressure of any species I is equal to the mole fraction of that species in the gas phase times the total pressure. So I can give you variations on initial concentration if I give you a gas phase reaction by, for example, telling you the mole fraction and the total pressure and the initial temperature. You could use this expression on the right to figure out what the initial concentrations are. I could give you the partial pressures at some initial temperature, and you could use that to figure out what those are. And it's not just like I need the ability to give you more complicated homework problems. That's how these things are actually represented. It's rare that you come across somebody that just gives you the initial concentration. They usually give you like partial pressures. An example of how to use that comes straight out of the ideal gas law. So there's, if you know how to do the ideal gas law, you know how to get C sub I for gases. Let's say there's, now I say that, and now watch, somebody's going to find a math mistake inside my little reactor here. Let's say it's initially at 350K, and the partial pressure of A is 0.6 bar, and the initial partial pressure of B is 0.7 bar. And I ask you to figure out what the concentrations are. That's using that expression that I had before. So CA0 is also equal to PA0 divided by RT0. About the only mistake that gets made here is which R we typically use. A semi-common one, actually even that one's not particularly common. Actually, I'm not going to give you a common one. That's not really a common one. Anyway, pick the right R, right, for whatever units of concentration that you happen to have. As an example, if we wanted to plug these numbers in, we could have 0.6 bar. If I go find any old R constant with something to do with bar and moles and Kelvin in it, One that you might pick up is 83.14, and that's cubic centimeters bar per mole K. And then you would multiply that by the absolute temperature, which is 350 K. The result is about 20.6, I'm going to have to squeeze the units in down here, moles per cubic meter. So again, the concentrations always look like moles per volume, so it'll always be moles per something. Mole per liter is a pretty common one, mole per cubic meter is pretty common, but it can be anything. Anything that looks like a mole per volume is fine. And then you would do the same exact thing for C sub B zero, which I'm not going to work out all the way, RT zero. But the number that I got for that is 24.0 moles per cubic meter. So this is just kind of a step that usually gets you started on a lot of problems. Somewhere along the way, you need to know how much stuff is there initially. And if it's a gas phase system, you can use the ideal gas law to help you out with something like that. If, again, it's liquid phase, kind of just have to tell you how much stuff is there. There's nothing else like this that we can use for a liquid phase. Any questions on that before we do the more complicated one, which is what comes after the reaction? Nope? Okay. I know I look down a lot, but you can, if you wave your hand, I have that, is it like Stockholm Syndrome or something, where I see something and I immediately associate it with a question? I can see that out of the corner of my eye fairly well, so just wave your hand if I'm looking down. So that was what happens if we wanted to know what the initial concentration was. If we want to know what the final concentration is, or more generally, what's the concentration at any time during the system, I'm going to use final here because we're going to talk about stoichiometric tables, which usually talk about before and after. But we're going to use it again to represent the concentration any time other than initially. The definition looks the same. It's C sub I is equal to N sub I over V. In fact, it's not just equal to that, it's defined as that. If you have a liquid, this is cool beans. There's nothing wrong with liquids, because with liquids, usually, in fact, for this class always, the initial constant or the initial volume V is always equal to the final volume V. So V sub zero is always equal to V for a couple of reasons. In general, liquids are incompressible. And because of one of the two following assumptions, which it really doesn't matter which assumption you want, one of the two could be true. Either the species that are reacting are dilute, so most of the volume here, most of V, is due to the inert. Excuse me. So an example of that would be something like a biological reaction where you just have a couple of like nanomoles or something of things inside a giant vat of water, and the water is essentially inert. In a case like that, the volume is essentially constant. Or if you still assume that they're incompressible, you can have two things that are true that also result in V naught being equal to V. One is that the overall number of moles doesn't change. Right, so for an example, an isomerization reaction, just A goes to B and back and forth between A and B, the overall number of mole delta will not change here. If you couple that with similar molar volumes, then you can result in a liquid system that essentially has constant volume. For us, these simplify to, if you see the word liquid, the volume is constant. The reason why that can be true is from either one of these, but we don't really care about which one of those is true in this class. If it's a liquid, the volume is constant. That's a pretty standard rule that we are not going to change at all for 113. If it's a liquid, the volume is constant. The irritating part is when you have a gas. It's not really irritating. I mean, I like the ideal gas law as much as the next person. If it's a gas, then we use the ideal gas law to get V. And specifically, we get V from V0. The reason for that is because very often in gases, things will change, right? Gases are pretty compressible, and we need to be able to represent how much things change when those gases undergo a reaction. If you write the ideal gas law as PV is equal to NTRT, this is talking about the after case, right? Or the outlet case, whichever one you want to call it. That's why it's N sub T and not N sub T zero. That's why it's T and not T sub zero. That's why it's P and not P sub zero. If you take the ratio of that compared to the initial conditions, so P zero, V zero is equal to N T zero, R T zero. So these are the initial conditions. This is the tool that lets us figure out what's happening to volume. If you rearrange these, which I usually need more space to do this, the volume after is proportional to the volume initially there times a bunch of ratios. And you get all these ratios just by rearranging that equation that we had right there at the top. P0 over P, T over T0, times N sub T over N sub T zero. So this will tell you whether or not volume is changing. If something is, for example, isothermal, isobaric, and the total number of moles doesn't change, then the system is also constant volume or isochoric. If we have multiple reactions, this is the form that we will always use, which we will have multiple reactions. Week four, I think we introduced multiple reactions. If we have multiple reactions, we always fall back to this particular form. If we have a single reaction, we can make that a little bit more, not necessarily user-friendly on the surface, but it is more user-friendly when it comes time to figure out what V is doing. And so the more user-friendly version for that, I'm gonna give a little bit of space here. That's always a red flag, right? When he moves away over to the left and starts writing again. T over T zero. P0 over P, those two don't change. But if you use that sum term that we had before, so I'm going to flip back, I'll come back to this in a minute. This term down here at the bottom, for N sub T, I can put that into that expression that I got from the ideal gas law and replace N sub T with all this information that's a function of nothing except the initial condition, the conversion that I've got, XA, and the change in stoichiometric coefficients. And that's what is usually done for a single reaction. So if you do that and work through all the algebra for that, that shouldn't be green, that should be white. You end up with 1 plus the mole fraction of A initially present times delta times XA. So this is the version that we usually use for a single reaction. The advantage of that is it's a little easier to figure out whether or not V is constant or not, because in general, the X will not be constant. It will not be zero. It'll be some positive number. So the only things that you need to worry about to determine whether or not something is isochoric or not, if it's constant volume, is you have to ask, is delta something other than zero, right? Did the total number of moles change? Is the pressure constant, and is the temperature constant? Generally, I can give you two of those. Sometimes I'll only give you one, and then you have to figure out what the other one is. I sort of implicitly give you delta every single time because I give you the reaction, so you can always calculate what delta is. But the other two, the temperature and the pressure, I would have to tell you something like isothermal or isobaric, or you would just have to guess based on this particular expression. Why does that tend to make things a little bit more difficult? It makes things more difficult because of what CI looks like. So CI, and I'm moving all the way over to the left right now, is equal to the moles of I divided by V. But now we have to plug in all of our terms for N sub I. We're going to replace all of those in terms of conversion X. Let's see. It's going to be about that big. Let's work on the bottom first. What do we do for V? For V, we just plug in exactly this expression. So copy-paste this expression and put it in the denominator of this one. So you've got V0 times T over T0 times P0 over P, and then that 1 plus YA0 delta times XA. I guess the length of that pretty well. We can clear that up over there. Right, that's what goes in the bottom. What goes in the top? We use that definition that we had originally from 100 that we modified at the beginning of today's lecture to represent how many moles are there afterwards in terms of conversion. So the ones that go on the top are Na0 times theta I minus the stoichiometric coefficient of I over the stoichiometric coefficient of A times XA. That is a useful general form of an equation to write down somewhere. So if you're producing your cheat sheet for the first exam, that's a good expression to have on there because it's very general. It's the general form that you can write the concentration of any species I after a reaction or at any point during a reaction using this particular equation for a single reaction. Just don't forget that this is for a single reaction. Often you will see a couple of little variations on something like this. Notice there's an Na0 over a V0. Right? That will always show up. No matter which species you're talking about, there's always an Na0 over a V0. And so sometimes you'll see that as Ca0. Right? It's the same thing. It's the initial amount of A there, the initial concentration of A. The other thing, which I'm not going to use this terminology very much, but if you're reading through your book, you should be aware that they use it sometimes. This term, the amount of A that's initially there, remember that YA0 is a mole fraction, times the delta is sometimes given the letter epsilon. It has no meaning beyond epsilon. It's defined as YA0 times delta. I don't use it very much because I don't think it's just one more term that you have to keep in your head, and it's not that hard to write YA0 times delta, but it is a term that gets used sometimes. There is no corresponding version of this equation that uses an epsilon if you have multiple reactions. If you have multiple reactions, just use this multiple reaction equation here, and that's what goes in your denominator. There's no shortcut way to write that in terms of conversion. If I want to write this in a stoichiometric table, I think we've got enough time to write a stoich table. This is where the CAs come in very handy. In fact, CAs going into a stoich table initially look pretty complicated, but since they come up in rate laws so often, a stoichiometric table becomes an excellent way to rearrange these things in a way that's reasonable for you to, for example, dump them into MATLAB and actually use them afterwards. Let's pick that same, actually, I think this is a No, I think that's the same reaction. Doesn't matter. 2A plus B goes to 3C. And let's say there's initially 50-50 or equal molar A and B. And it's in there at 2 bar. The volume is initially 1 cubic meter. And it's 325K. We're going to assume here that the temperature and the pressure are constant. I could tell you a variety of different things being constant, right? I could tell you temperature and volume are constant. I could just tell you volume is constant. Everything that we're going to do, at least for this week, and actually next week, I think just this week, is isothermal, so we'll always see T and P being constant. And in fact, I think we're only going to have enough time to get through the first column of this, and we'll come back to the second column tomorrow. So the stoichiometric table is built up of the same initial columns, so it's still species, stoichiometric coefficient of I. Instead of the moles of I, we can write the concentration of I, which again, this will always have units that look like moles per volume. I'm just going to use moles per cubic meter because I happen to have those units handy. Since we have to use it a lot, I'm in the habit of writing a theta I column. And then we need a C sub I column. The C sub I column is where you spend most of your effort in terms of thinking about which terms go in and where. Again, we'll have to do as much as we can here in less than a minute. Rows don't look any different. A, B, C, minus 2, minus 1, plus 3. How would I get CI for a system like this? Yes?
Oh, I have two CI columns.
Oh, yeah, sorry, that's CI 0. Thank you. Based on what we did a couple of minutes ago, how do I get CI 0 given that information? It's the initial moles divided by the initial volume. What's the initial volume? 1 cubic meter. What's the initial moles? It would be 50 times the coefficient, but what equation do we need to use to get that? Yeah, the ideal gas equation. Right, so this is one way that that would look, right? I told you it's a 50-50 mixture of A and B, which means if I want CA0, that's the same as YA0 times the total initial pressure divided by R times the total initial temperature. And so now I know YA0 is 0.5 because I said it's an equal molar mixture, 50-50 mixture of A and B. And I know the initial pressure is 2 bar, and I know the initial temperature is 325 K. I would do something similar for B, which I know my rows are getting a little bit off here. YB0 times P0 divided by RT0. And what's C sub C0?
Zero.
Zero. There's none of that present, so we don't have to worry about it. You kind of need to stretch out those first two columns. So tomorrow we'll look at what the last column looks like here. There's nothing new there. I'm not going to introduce any new ideas. So if you want to go ahead and apply this expression, you can do it. That's all we're going to do at the beginning of Wednesday's lecture. And then we'll look at rate laws. Don't forget, homework's due Wednesday.